So we got an update on a video I dropped the other day. The preschooler, the 5-year-old, who was shot inside the house in the Roseland neighborhood. It was actually not a one family home. It was a apartment building with several units in the building. And he was shot inside the head while he was playing with his iPad, by a shooter who did a drive-by, leaning out of the car as it was moving outside the building, as you guys saw on the video. Now, the police came out with a statement and said that they do not believe that that particular apartment unit was the target. So, anyway, he is doing better. The family thanks everybody for their prayers. The young boy is now out of the medically induced coma. The swelling in his brain has been brought to a level where he's now responsive and he's doing dramatically better from what he was doing a few days ago. So the family thanks everybody, and the reward now is up to 10 grand. It was originally 500 bucks, but community activists and the police have come together to up the reward money. So $10,000 for any info leading to the shooter. Now, people were saying, based on the video, you can't really see anything, that the video is not going to help anything. I think it's actually going to help a lot. I mean, somebody's going to recognize that car who's from the neighborhood where the guys are from, that are into it with those guys over there, or knows somebody that they're into it with. It may not be gang related, it may be personal. So they, somebody from his neighborhood might know their personal business. And that's usually the way it goes. I mean, yes, there's a million cars out there that look like that, but not from every single neighborhood. Plus, a lot of guys, like, they kind of do these shootings the same way over and over again. People who follow this thing know everybody's kind of got their own. I mean, I hate to like trivialize it like this, but everybody's got kind of got their own style. And leaning out that car from the opposite side of the car, you know what I'm saying, while it's driving past like that, that's not something that everybody does. So I don't know. We'll see if anybody can ID this. And you can remain anonymous. Now, here's the thing: the guys might put two and two together and say, well, he's the only one who knew, so he must have been the one who told. If you're in that situation, you might want to, like I said, take charge of your own security. If you think there's going to be retaliation for telling, this needs to happen, because somebody who uses that method, to do their hits or whatever, that's a danger to the public. He's not even hitting the right unit, you know what I'm saying, let alone the right person. Like, he's hitting the whole wrong apartment unit. So I don't know if somebody just gave him bad intel on that, or if the aim was just bad, but shooting from a moving car is never a good idea. So anyways, this happened in the Roseland neighborhood, okay? And I just wanted to give a little brief history for people, who aren't that familiar with that part of the city, about this neighborhood, exactly what this neighborhood is. A lot of you guys, have heard me refer to this neighborhood by several different names: Roseland, the Hundreds, the Wild Hundreds. Sometimes I just call it way out south. So they're from like the opposite end of the city from where I'm from. Okay, and this didn't used to be a part of the city of Chicago. It became incorporated into the city later. Everybody knows Chicago is notorious for being a segregated city. Up north, that's changed a lot in recent years, but historically, it's been that, and not just racially. It's segregated ethnically, or it has been in the past. And so, when the European immigrants were first coming into Chicago, and European immigrants were really the only population in Chicago, every European immigrant group kind of had their own community where they spoke their language, they had their stores, everybody that could hook you up with a job was around you because you were from the same place. So Roseland, the far hundreds, south of downtown, the streets are numbered. Okay, north of downtown, the streets go by names. South of downtown, some of them go by names, but a lot of the streets are numbered down there, as far as like the streets that run east-west. Okay, by which you measure the latitude that you're at, as far as like the grid that Chicago is laid out in. So as you go south, the numbers get higher. So the hundreds are the furthest south that you go before you hit the suburbs, before you hit the far south suburbs. So, after 99th Street, then 100th, 101st, 102nd. This area was originally kind of a agrarian area, like a farmland type area, and it was settled by Dutch immigrants. This is all the way back in the 1800s. But that changed. Okay, the ethnic makeup of the neighborhood has changed several times. First, it was Dutch. Then, The Pullman car factory came there. Now, this is railroad cars we're talking about. George Pullman set up a community for his factory workers to manufacture his railroad cars, and the Pullman neighborhood was basically born out of that. Okay, so that factory attracted people to the Roseland neighborhood and to the surrounding neighborhoods who were not Dutch, who were from other ethnic groups. And these are European ethnic groups we're talking about. Mostly Italians were one of the biggest. A lot of Italians from the west side started moving down there, bringing their, you know, trade skills with them. So the Pullman thing continued for a while. That eventually fell off. So the ethnic makeup of the neighborhood changed. The layout of the neighborhood changed, and it became more urban. And then over time, as the economy changes, you had black residents started to move in from the south, okay, 40s, 50s, 60s. And I'm not sure, it was kind of gradual down there. I'm not sure the exact point at which it totally flipped. But now the area is predominantly black. And a lot of, you know, real estate agents were using like blockbuster tactics down there. You had people, you know, selling those cribs, white flight taking place. And there was kind of a wave. I wasn't alive at the time, but so I can't give firsthand accounts of this, but I would say like 50s, 60s, 70s, you had a wave of people moving out of there. Now there's still a few whites down there, but I would say vast majority now down there is black. So as far as, you know, and it's been that way probably for the past 50 years. There were still some whites there up until like the 80s, I would say, some that were, you know, sticking around. But if you go down there, you see that it looks like the suburb. I mean, it looks very nice. You know, you have some parts of Chicago that are like now considered impoverished high crime areas that don't look that way at all. The east side is the biggest example of this. Okay, those used to be like rich Jewish neighborhoods. And the homes that they're living in over there are still the same that those rich were living in there back when it was that. So it looks gorgeous over there. There's certain real estate that's just so valuable that they become targets for gentrification. So that area is starting to change. It's getting more Latino now, and there's some whites moving back into South Shore. But in the hundreds, it looks like the suburbs. I mean, you go up to the north suburbs, northwest suburbs, and then you go down to Roseland, and you're going to see the same type of stuff. You know what I'm saying? The same type of homes, the same type of layout, urban planning and stuff like that. And you can tell that this was once, you know, a middle class to upscale community. So the reputation now, you know, how it got the nickname the Wild Hundreds, which is nicknamed the residents down there gave it. I mean, this is not people from the outside like stereotyping or anything, like people that live there named it that. It got that way because now, typically, if you look at the numbers, it makes the top four or five most violent neighborhoods in Chicago consistently. It's normally Garfield Park 1, Inglewood 2, Austin is usually third or fourth, and then West Humboldt Park, and then Roseland. So Inglewood and Roseland would be like the two south side neighborhoods, the other three are west side. So, you know, that's given it kind of a negative reputation. And in recent years, it's had some events and people come out of that neighborhood that have kind of cemented that reputation. So you had about 10 years ago, you had an incident that got national attention in which a student at Fenger High School, which is one of the high schools down there, Darion Albert was beaten to death outside the school. And this is going back to what I was saying the other day about fighting. It can happen with a fight too. Yeah, Darion Albert, rest in peace to him. That drew national attention. But the three high schools down there, you got Fenger, you got Corliss. Julian is also down there. Julian, I'm not too sure about, having worked in the schools. I've never been to Julian and don't know too much about that. But Fenger and Corliss, especially Corliss, have reputations. At least I wasn't working at Corliss, but just in the system talking to other people. Beyond that, you know, you had the rapper Lil Mouse come out of there, kind of like gassing up the street reputation down there. And I'm not saying that he was blowing it out of proportion. I think what he was portraying was pretty accurate based on the news reports. And then you had, you know, Zach TV, who originally was from there, but he moved down to the south suburbs and, you know, he was killed. And the gang conflicts down there now, you got a lot of gangs that are among the most violent gangs in the city. You got Risky Road, the Four Corner Hustlers. And by the way, I'm talking about the whole Wild Hundreds now, not just Roseland. You know, Roseland is the most well-known neighborhood down there, but I'm talking about the whole hundreds. You got Risky Road, You got Wentworth, Wentworth Mob. They're into it with Zach TV's neighborhood. Okay, 10-5 MMG. Risky Roads over on 10-4 Maryland. You know, you got those Altgeld Gardens projects, which are one of the worst in the city, or public housing, I should say. Altgeld Gardens, there's a huge war down there going on. It's been just, man, really adding to the body count. So Roseland has gotten a more negative reputation in recent years. And it was going back to when I was a little kid, it was always kind of iffy, but it seems like in the past 10 years, it's really just gone off the charts as far as, like, you know, the gang wars. So I don't know if this was that. It might have been personal, but you normally, when you have gentrification, you've got, like, encroachment from other communities that are more upscale next to it. And most of the south suburbs around there are not, like, upscale suburbs. You know what I'm saying? They're pretty much economically, like, on the same level as Roseland, Harvey, and all those areas. So I'm not sure that Roseland, I wouldn't say, is a prime target for any kind of demographic change anytime soon. The east side is a different story. That income level is just going through the roof as, like, richer people move into those gorgeous homes down there. You know what I'm saying? So just be on the lookout for that. I'm not, you know, I'm not telling you what to think. I'm not promoting it. I'm not saying it's good or bad. But, you know, that definitely, that real estate over there is just too sweet. Right off the lake, nice houses, you know what I'm saying? Access to public transportation, all that. But I digress. So thankfully this little boy survived, and Roseland is the type of area where this thing can happen, man. So, you know, be smooth if you're down there. And if you're thinking of moving out of one dangerous area to get away from all that stuff, Roseland isn't one of the places that I would pick, at least not now. It's your boy, Windy City Report. I'm out.